But anyways, I'm gonna introduce the next speaker, right? And the next speaker is Anne-Marie, and she is an amazing woman. She's trying to promote science, technology, education, and math to women, trying to get a lot more women. Oh, there you go.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good to see you. Yeah. All right.
Good morning, everybody.
Is it working?
Hello.
Yes. Whoa. Yes. Good morning.
Good morning. Come on, wake up.
No.
No? Not gonna work. All right. So you want to introduce Anne-Marie then?
Go ahead.
Okay. So yes, as I was saying, she is from an organization called STEM. She was also the youngest ever graduate from Oxford, right? And she got 2 degrees, I think, by the time she was 20. And she's doing a lot of work to promote science, technology, education, math to women around the world, right? So with that, we'd like to welcome Anne-Marie up on stage. So Anne-Marie, come on up. Welcome. Good to see you here.
And
welcome.
Thank you very
much. I know that there's not a lot of people in the audience just yet.
You know,
we're all starting to come in. A lot of people are in the meetings already, but we also have a live stream for you. And there's, I think, quite a lot of people watching the live stream. So they're with us today. And the stage is yours. Thank you for coming over.
Thank you very much. My clicker. Brilliant. Fantastic. So, hi, everyone. I know that that's the Finnish way of saying hello, so I hope I've pronounced that correctly. My name is Anne-Marie Imafidon, and I'm going to speak today about a key factor of success and why it is that we're actually snatching defeat from the jaws of victory when we talk about the tech world and our startup scenes. And for me, I'm quite excited to be here. Firstly, because it's my first time ever in Finland, first time ever in Helsinki. So thank you very much for your warm welcome. But also because of these two ladies, Anna and Teresa, who I'm not sure if any of you recognize them or what their startup might be. No? But they actually invented the Hovdig as part of a master's that they did over in Sweden. So this is the closest I've ever been to Sweden in my life. So I'm quite excited to be here in Finland. They are great examples and great role models that we talk to girls all over Europe about in terms of women in STEM and when we talk about women in the industry. And for me, the reason why this is really important is, as was mentioned in my intro, you know, I've always been a girl, I've always been a woman, I've always been female, and I've always been really interested in technology. To the point that I did do this when I was younger, so 11, when I was 11, I'm a little bit older than 11 now. But when I was 11, I passed an A-level in computer science. And since then, no other girl has come up and done that and beaten that record. And it's quite sad. But it's also rather strange, because if we look back through history, women and technology actually go pretty well together. So I've got a couple of examples here that you may have seen before or might recognize. Does anyone recognize the first lady on the left? Anyone? No, not one hand. So this is the first ever programmer. Just over 200 years ago, her name's Ada Lovelace, and she wrote the first ever computer program for a computer. And it was actually to work out the sequence of Bernoulli numbers. But she was the first ever programmer of any kind, male or female, ever. The second lady, does anyone recognize who she is? Couple of you maybe. So that's Stephanie Shirley, who was actually a big tech pioneer in the 60s and founded the first kind of distributed tech house. So what she actually did was she was a mathematician herself and got women who had, you know, taken time up from work, maybe who were mathematical, to actually write codes and write programs from their kitchen table and then send it in. So they actually coded the black box for Concord. And coded quite a number of different things throughout the 60s. So they were a software house. The third lady, does anyone recognize her? No? Yes, they've got a nodding. So this is Hedy Lamarr, who you might recognize because that's one of her Hollywood photos, because she was a great actress, but she was also a fantastic inventor and co-inventor, actually, of spread spectrum frequency hopping, which if you've never heard of, most of you here will have heard of Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. Yeah, that's the technology that underpins that. So you've got Hedy to thank for the Wi-Fi that you're using today. And finally, another lady from Europe on the very end. Does anyone recognize who she is or what she's holding? No. So this is Angela Ruiz Robler, who is actually a Spanish lady, and she's holding the first ever e-book. So this is a patent that she filed in 1949. She was actually a teacher who wanted to use technology to help her students, was trying to solve a problem. So she invented this e-book that would mean that they wouldn't have to carry their textbooks and heavy books around all day. So if we look back through history, there are loads and countless numbers of women that we know of who have been great at technology, have solved problems and built great products that we still use or still take advantage of today. And there are also many who are not written about or have been written out of history. So just last week in the UK, we had a big story about Isambard Brunel and the fact that there was a mum of six who had designed the big iconic bridge in Bristol, but had actually handed him the plans because she didn't want to be boastful about her work. And so we've got many examples of women in history who've actually been great problem solvers, used technology and built great products that we still use today. There are also examples of times when women are actually the solutions to our problems, or we need to incorporate women to build better products and better solutions. So this is one example. This is me stood next to someone called John. Anyone recognize John? No, I'm a big one for audience participation. So this is John, who was the original voice of Siri, which most of you will have heard of before. Most people here have used Siri. There we go. A hand up. Thank you very much, gentlemen. You like Siri. But the technology for Siri, as most of us will know, has been around for decades. So voice recognition technology isn't something new, however new Siri might be. And you've got to ask yourself the question, why is it that it took so long for us to get decent voice recognition that could actually hear what you're saying? So most of us will remember, you know, if you go a couple years back, you'd say, hey, Siri, or ye olde Siri. You know, I need directions to cable factory. And it'd say, did you ask for ice cream? You'd say, no, there's nothing like what I just said. And why is that? Well, again, you need diverse teams. What they'd done was initially the people that were building this product didn't actually factor in different voices. Female voices are slightly different from male voices. Some of you may have noticed. And so the technology then didn't work and couldn't take off and wasn't widely usable. So it was when we included more voices that we were able to have Siri or Cortana or, you know, your favorite voice recognition software. Another example is this. So these are seat belts and airbags, which again, we're kind of veering towards the engineering end of things rather than technology. But again, most of you have seen maybe an average woman or an average girl and an average man. There's a slight difference. The average male is taller than the average woman. Agreed? Maybe. Average, we're talking not every woman. And the average male is heavier than the average woman as well. No offense. And so the first seat belts were built to the specifications of the average male and not the average woman, and actually killed women and children, despite the fact that as a product, it was supposed to save lives. Right, so it's a matter of death, life and death, really, for you, your startup, for us as humans, that we make sure that we incorporate women and a diversity of people in the products that we build and when we're building things. And for us in the EU, at least kind of across Europe, I know different countries vary and we're not all the same, but the participation of women in building these products and in STEM fields is shockingly low. So this is a number from, and I think an EC WIT report last year or the year before around participation of women in particular within what we call the ICT sector, so within technology. In the UK, we're at about 17% in technology itself, 13% in STEM. And if we look across Europe, we're only at 30%, which is shocking, given that we've got a lot of women that are maybe graduating these courses, but also a lot of women that are in the workforce, right? So we're about 50-50 in the workforce these days in terms of, you know, how many women that we have versus how many men. And so it's actually shocking that for something that's a fairly new industry, we're almost recreating old hierarchies and recreating kind of bad habits that we've seen in other industries. So what can we do? What should we be doing? I'd like to call on you today. You always got to use a big motivational quote from an inspirational figure. So my figure this morning is Gandhi. And I'm going to call on you to be the change that you want to see in the world, or at least be the change that I'd like to see in the world. And the change, and us including these women, us including diversity, us having better representation, building better products, And doing better and having success in our startups is all hinged on us making sure that we have everyone along with us. Again, you'll see it more and more. We have more and more women gaming. So I think now it's 60% of gamers are actually female. 80-odd percent of purchasing decisions are made by women. You don't want to be missing out on that with poor numbers in your startup and in your company. So what do we do? So you are the change you want to see in the world. I want to call out Jan and the organizers of Arctic15, who this year have really consciously tried to make sure that they've got a 50-50 panels and speaker list for the conference, and they've managed to do that. You know, whether it's tough, whether it was easy, they did it, and we got there, and we are here, we are 50-50. But I want to call on you as well to make sure that you are also part of that change and you are doing what you can. So not all of you organize conferences, but there are a lot of things that you can do, and I'd like to help you feel empowered to be able to do that. Is that okay? Kind of want to empower you and gift you with a couple of things that you can do. So I've got five things for you to make sure that you're trying to do, or at least getting involved with, to make sure that we can increase these numbers for your own success and for the success of your products and your startups that you're building. Step one, or option one, is the Rooney Rule. And so how many of you have heard of this before? It's not got anything to do with Wayne Rooney, but I thought I'd put that photo up as I'm a Brit and got to represent sometimes. There we go. So the Rooney Rule was actually brought in by this guy on the right called Dan Rooney, who worked at the NFL. And the NFL was quite well known, or was known, about 10, 15 years ago for having a really big diversity problem. So what they saw was that if you look at the football teams and their kind of makeup and the diversity of them, you had a lot of Afro-American players coming through, doing really well, having great careers, but not actually progressing on to become coaches or to become managers. Despite the fact that you had people who were maybe non-African-American who also were having great careers, but were then going on to have really fulfilling careers as coaches. And so what Dan Rooney said and did and brought in, what the Rooney Rule meant, was that for every coaching position at any NFL team across the whole of the NFL, you had to make sure that you always interviewed at least one African-American for the position. And this wasn't forcing them to hire them. This wasn't forcing you to do anything that's untoward. It was just interview an African-American. Just consider at least one every time you're hiring for a new coaching position. And this has worked really well for them. They've seen the numbers, you know, climb over the years just by saying you have to consider someone. It wasn't that you have to hire, but you have to consider them. So we're seeing this now, more and more companies, at least in the UK tech scene, are taking this on and saying, okay, cool, we want to make sure that when we're hiring, we interview at least one woman, or at least one BME, Black Minority Ethnic, or at least one person that's different from our norm, different from our majority. And that's all it is. And it's interesting to see, you know, for those of you that use recruiters, or those of you that, you know, you've all got your various ways of hiring, how maybe just considering that and just sending that message to the people that you work with or in your hiring ecosystem can mean that you see their behaviors start to change. So Rooney Rule, that's number one. Number two is looking at your job descriptions and making sure that they are neutral and inclusive. And I've got a picture of a ninja here. It's something that I hope we don't see as much here in Finland as we do in the UK, but a lot of people trying to hire code ninjas who will be there all hours of the day and will give their all to the startup. There are certain people who maybe identify as ninjas. There are a lot of people who you might want to have in your startup helping you solve problems that don't identify as ninjas. And sometimes the language that you can use can put people off. The other example that we see a lot in research is in terms of when you put down things that are requirements versus suggested or optional. A lot of times women might look at the list of 10 and they'll think, oh, I can only do maybe 5 or 6, so I'm not going to apply yet. I don't think I'm ready for this. Whereas some guys will look at it and go, hey, I've got 3. I'll make the rest of it up when I get there. So you want to make sure that when you're writing your list, you're writing things that are open, that are neutral, and that are allowing all kinds of people to feel like it's the kind of role that they can apply for. There's great tools out there as well that will help you test this on your job descriptions. It's always nice and eye-opening to do that. So Textio is one example. You just literally lift your job description, paste it in Textio, and it will kind of highlight certain words that you might have. Maybe not just ninja, but other things that you've got in there that aren't very inclusive. The next example is to make sure you have a code of conduct. And this is something that, again, we're seeing more and more for conferences, but also for the place of work. So you want to make sure that you have an environment that allows the women that are already there to stay, and that also encourages them or allows them to feel safe enough to encourage others to come and join them. So whether it's a code of conduct around how you handle complaints within your organization, whether it's a code of conduct around your language and how you actually work with each other and see each other within the office and the workspace, whether it's a code of conduct around how you do your meetings and how you conduct business and who it is that you invite and who you listen to in your meetings, make sure that you do kind of put some rules down, a code of conduct that you will ascribe to and you will say that you will do, that you won't end up undermining people without realizing it or talking over them in meetings or, you know, taking ideas and doing that kind of thing. So code of conduct is the third one. The fourth one is to collaborate and share with others. So a little bit of a shout out here for Girls in Tech Helsinki. In the UK, we are part of something called the Tech Talent Charter. That is a number of companies that are coming together that are saying that they want to make positive movements and they want to kind of move the dial on the diversity in their companies. And it's almost like if everyone else is doing it, it becomes the norm, it becomes the culture, and it becomes the way that everyone does it. So it's hard for you maybe to be the pioneer and be the first, but if you've got others that are already doing it and you're joining with them, it makes it a lot easier. It also means that you're able to be more visible as an organization that's looking to do this and looking to hire, which means that you then have a lot more or a diverse set of candidates coming to you. So another example of this that we've seen is Salesforce, who you will have seen have been really open about their push for diversity, their push around the pay gap, their push around kind of inclusiveness in their environment and in their offices. And it's meant that now they're the example that people can point to and there's no excuse why you wouldn't, because, you know, what's the difference between you and Salesforce? And also, there's been a huge return on investment for Salesforce in doing those initiatives. So it's not that they've lost money or they've reduced in their quality of their product by hiring more women and deciding to treat their women and other diverse people better. Actually, it's been a huge return on investment and they're growing and doing better and better for it. The final thing for you to do, or I'd like for you all to do, is to get used to challenging others when the diversity isn't there. I love this meme on the right. Do you see a princess when you should see an engineer? And on the left, we've got the allmalepanels.tumblr, which you might have seen before. If you call people out, if you're brave enough to do that, if you're collaborating with others and you're able to do it as a group, you'll find that they're more willing and they're able to change their behaviors a lot quicker than if maybe we just kind of allowed it and said, yeah, it's fine. You know, there's not that many women around anyway. So if you join in and actually challenge others, of course you have to have your house in order before you do it. So don't throw stones without due course. But get ready to challenge others or be open and be prepared to challenge others. And you'll be able to see, you know, just with these five steps, just making the effort. If you don't intentionally include, you're unintentionally excluding. So make sure that you are doing that. And those are five steps that you can follow to do that. So that's talking about the present. I talked a little bit about history in the past, talking about the present, what you can do now. But the other thing to do is to look to the next generation and to the future, which is actually what me and my company and my team do on our work within the Stemettes. So as was mentioned, we work with girls aged between 5 and 21. We run hackathons, we run mentoring schemes, we run workshops, and we actually bring them into industry and sometimes bring them to conferences like this to show them what it's all about and why it's somewhere that actually is going to be a really good place for them to be when they eventually grow up. And for us, we run a number of different initiatives. This is one of them. We run a big house, incubator house. It was Big Brother meets The Apprentice meets Dragon's Den type house. We've got a documentary coming out later this summer. But there are loads of things that you can do and loads of things that you can get involved with as well in terms of inspiring the next generation and working with them. And so to close, I wanted to share with you a little bit about what we do and what we tell them so that as you are collaborating, as you are working maybe with Girls in Tech Helsinki or with other organizations, maybe Coda Dojo might be another one that some of you are working with. Here are, again, five is a magic number, five reasons why a young girl, young woman, young person might want to join the tech industry that you can maybe repeat back to them to do your bit for the next generation and for the future. So reason number one is that tech is an incredibly altruistic industry, sorry, to be in incredibly altruistic and incredibly creative. I think there's a lot of focus that we have within the EU, at least, on things like qualifications and rote learning, and you must know the knowledge, and you know, it's all about being able to recall this theorem. But actually, it's a lot about being creative, being altruistic, helping others, and problem solving, which, again, you know, within education, we're not necessarily the best at communicating that. So examples are, you know, the girls in the top left have turned a litre of urine into 6 hours of electricity. The girls in the top right have found a bacteria that shortens the germination process, and so is going to help a lot with the kind of food problem that we have. The girl at the bottom, her grandfather has Parkinson's, and so she invented this kind of sippy cup that will never spill for him to be able to drink and be independent. And of course, the ladies down the bottom that I mentioned from Sweden, they've invented a new cycle helmet that actually doesn't affect your hair, so it kind of goes around your neck and inflates on impact and actually collects data about your accident when it happens. Which I know this is Helsinki, you saw a lot of cycles this morning, so a couple of you might appreciate having a helmet like that. The second reason I like to give the girls, and this is the second, not the first, is all around pay. So it's a pretty well-paid industry to be in. Our pay gap is a lot smaller than it is in a lot of other industries. And as a woman in STEM, you stand to earn sometimes up to 30% more than your counterparts who aren't working in STEM, so science, technology, engineering, and maths-related careers. So that's reason two. Reason three is the free swag that you get at conferences. So Arctic15 has been really good on this. We've got lots of freebies around and about. This is a conference that we take the girls to in the States every year. And this was day one of swag. This was day three of swag. And it's all free, of course, as we know. They don't all know that. So for a lot of people, this is quite an interesting perk to have if you're working in the industry. We talk about gaming. A lot of them like games. And to think that you can go to gaming conferences and leave with games, it's mind-blowing. The fourth reason is the free food, which again, Arctic15 has kind of been up there with Epic, the startup, with our free food and making sure that we've got some good stuff to eat. And the fifth and final, and I'm going to end on this, is you can wear what you want. So this is me taking selfies at my desk. You can see I've got a bit of a cold in the top, in the middle, and everyone's completely fine with that. I know today we're all wearing pretty much as we wish as well. So that's it, really. It's a bit the past, the present, and the future of having diverse teams. And I want to end on this in particular. So this is a more modern example of where you definitely want to make sure that you're including women, at least in your products, for your success. So this is Apple's health kit that they launched a couple years ago. And what was really interesting to note was that it was a health kit that was to measure everything about your health. So this, from the steps that you take to your heart rate, and it measured everything about your health, but it forgot that for 50% of the population, 50% of their users, there was a rather large part of their health, i.e. menstruation. And so there was a lot of uproar when this came out, and we said, wait, hang on a second, do we not matter? Do the parts of my health that don't matter? Are there parts of me? How did that get past it? Were you not listening to the women in your team, or did you not have women in your team? And they've actually had to go back and add this into the product. So you want to make sure, again, for your success and for your product and for what you're doing, and to make sure that you're not taking defeat from the jaws of victory, that you do have a diverse team, you do have women in your team. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much. Awesome. Hey, we wanted to do something a little special, right, as well. We want to support what you're doing, right? So we want to give Stemettes a €500 award, kind of a contribution, thanks to Arctic15 and Arctic Startup, so we can also help the cause. So thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much. Thank Lovely you. Check. Thank you.
Let's do a quick photo, all right?
Yeah.
Cool.
We'll have to see if the bank will take it off us.
Yeah, you take it to the bank, you know, in Finland, they love checks.
Yeah. Thank you very much.